Well, Jeff, today's a really cool day. We're gonna hit some rock and roll and a cool ride. Today we're going to see Gary Nightingale in Fredericton. He's a really serious musician, and he's a major drummer. And of course he plays all kinds of stuff, so we're gonna get to meet Gary. And today we're cruising around in the 2008 40th anniversary Bullet Mustang. And if you remember the movie Bullet, with Steve McQueen, 1968, he had this version of the 1968, so lots of power, 4.6 liter, 5-speed. This is a classic, it's a collector's car, so we're pretty pumped to go for a spin.
All right, let's hit the road.
Let's go. Whoa!
So my passion for music started at a very young age. My father was really big in the music industry. He's a country hall of famer, played in Nashville. Anyway, I grew up with my father constantly playing guitar. But around the age of 16, I'd say, I started falling in love with a lot of different bands. And I just, like Motley Crue, for example. I saw Looks at Kill, the video. I think that's what it's called. Anyway, and it was so cool. And back then, I mean, they were the coolest band ever. So I bought a set of drumsticks and I would just kind of air band with drumsticks. And one of my friends one day said, you know, it looks like you're really playing this song. I'm like, have you ever played drums before? I'm like, no, I wouldn't know where to start. So he suggested I try and get a drum set. So I called Tony's Music Box, a local music store here, Mike George, bless his heart. And I asked him if I could try a set of drums. So he rented me a set of drums, a 5-piece kit. And I set it all up. And so I didn't know where to start. So I had never even sat behind a drum set before. So I sat behind the kit and I took my little radio and I put on that song and I played it note for note. And I'd never, like, it shocked me that I actually did play it. And I even had the drums, stick spins and everything in the video. I did the same thing. So another song that I was practicing at the same time was Van Halen's Jump. So I hit Jump and I played it note for note as well. And that's when it was all really, because I knew, right, it's like, this seems to be natural for me. One of my friends, he played bass, and all he played was Rush, period. And I said to him, as a drummer, I want to play with you. And he said, can you play Rush? And I said, who's that? I had never heard them before. So he said, after he scolded me for being so weak, he put on a song called YYZ. And I heard that, and I'm like, oh my God, what is that? So then he played a couple more songs like Tom Sawyer, which again, I mean, most people know, have heard that song at some point on the radio. But the song that he played for me that I knew I was going to become a Rush clone, it's called The Weapon. And at the very first, it's a very intricate, very syncopated beat at first. And I hadn't taken drum lessons up to this point. And I heard that and I couldn't play it. There was no way humanly possible that I could play it. It was way over my head. If you listen to that song, it's really complicated. I spent years listening to that. I'm not kidding. Years listening to it on loop. Every night I would go to sleep and I would put it on loop so I could hear it while I slept. Because I wanted to learn it so bad. And I would go in every day and I would spend hours behind the drum set and I couldn't get it. So I started taking drum lessons at that point because I knew I'm missing some serious pieces of the puzzle. So I took drum lessons from a guy by the name of Wayne Blanchard, who's the marketing communications manager for Sabian at the time. And I spent years with him, and he could see my passion for music. So we went way past just your normal drum lessons. He would invite me to his house and we would spend hours and hours and hours listening to songs and working on just snare drum rudiments and stuff like that. And I still at this So this is years of me training. I still couldn't do it. And then one night, every single night, I'm not kidding, I would go to sleep and I would put that song on loop. And one morning I woke up and the bells went off and I ran into my drum set. I hit the play button and bam, I was in. I knew it. I could feel it. It was easy, you know, at that point. But it was just from years of, you got to get your brain right to play Rush, man. You got to have it together. I went through my father, my grandmother, my uncle, all dying of cancer at the same time. My wife had eye cancer, the most rarest form of eye cancer. So there was about a 10-year period where I just stopped playing because the joy had been sucked out of the room. How can I sit here and have fun while everyone else is suffering? And one of my very good friends, Jeff Chase, he called me up and he told me Rush was going to be playing in Halifax. And up to this point, I had stopped playing. I had completely stopped because I had kind of become depressed. And he said to me, you know, Rush is playing. And I said, no, I'm not going. Because at this point, I wasn't even listening to music. I wouldn't turn on the radio, nothing. If I got in the car and the radio was on, mute. Like, I stopped. Because I just was in that zone. And anyway, Jeff said to me, Rush is playing. And I'm like, I can't go see them. I can't. I'm not going. Anyway, so he said to me, he said, I think you're depressed. And of course, that angered me to no end, because to me, logically, I could not be depressed. That's not the kind of person I am. But so I said, all right, I'm going. Just to prove him wrong. So we went to Halifax. And when Rush hit the stage, my jaw dropped. They were amazing. I couldn't take my eyes off of Neil Peart. He didn't miss one single note. He didn't miss anything. And I know these songs inside and out. I've been working on them for years. So I watched them and I was just so amazed. And if you know anything about Neil's story, about the tragedies that man has gone through, to see him up on stage smiling and playing the way that he was, I kind of said to myself, what's my excuse? If he can do it after all the things he's been through, why can't I? Rush brought me out of my depression. There's no question that Rush totally changed my life again. They changed my life when I was a young man, and they completely brought me out of depression. Because again, and I've read Neil's books, I've read a lot about Neil. He's not just a drummer that I like. He was my mentor. He became my therapist. You know, he and I have a lot in common, our love for motorcycles. I really kind of dove in to Neil, and his passion was very obvious. Anyway, so I personally, you know, again, I love the band Rush. I love them a lot, but they really, they're not just a band for me. They changed my life for the better.
When we first showed up, I had a misconception on the size of the room, because all I saw was photos or videos of Gary playing in this room. And I thought literally that the room was about twice the size. So I had a whole different idea in my mind of how I was going to set lighting and things like that. So as soon as we came in, immediately I had to change my plan, because my idea was not going to fit. So that means big umbrellas, big soft boxes, and four or five lights and things like that, back lights. So all of a sudden that wasn't going to work. So I had to tone it down in lighting from five lights to two, right? And also limited on space for umbrella. So that's where I used the walls and the ceilings to bounce light, so I could basically flood the whole scene. I used one set of one light on a stand pointing at the wall or the ceiling or in between the two, and the whole thing was lighting in a sense of flooding the whole scene. So that was my fill light. The other light that I used, which would have been right behind me here, kind of pointing at a 90 degree angle to Gary and his drums, is what I used as a main light. So that was the more powerful light balance, and I had it balanced at a aperture of about f11, And the other one was about 5.6 and a half to F8. So that gave me a ratio. In other words, when the main light hits, and I use the same idea, by the way, using the corner or the ceiling, the light. So when the main light hit, which was a little bit more powerful than the other light, what happens there is it creates modeling. It creates, you know, everything was lit evenly, but it also creates modeling in a sense that you see shape, and you can see basically what I'm trying to incorporate here is a three-dimensional look in a two-dimensional platform. Because of time, because of limited space, etc., when I had my lights set up, I was set up for a shutter speed of 1/250th of a second. And what that guaranteed me is it just froze the action. It just made sure that everything was frozen. Usually, when you do stuff like this, is you slow down your shutter speed so you can see movement. I chose to go the opposite this time for that reason. Because of limited space, limited time, I wasn't sure how fast he was going to use. So every time I would have had to readjust and just play a little bit. So I just thought that I'm going to just keep it nice and sharp and solid right straight through. So I went with a higher shutter speed this time. Okay. I wanted to test my parabolic reflector, and I wanted to just do kind of a headshot with him using the drums as a background. And this particular item, I love it because it's one light source, it's very directional, but in this case, it's all metal, it's all aluminum, so it's very harsh type of light. But inside, there's a little bowl, light hits, goes back, and then comes out. In this case, I used a diffuser in front of it that was going to just diffuse the light a little bit more, make it softer, but very directional. So by placing the light a little further away, or as far as I could make it, gave me a lot of the contrast that I wanted, because part of the photographs, I wanted to have shadow and light. Drum kit, because there's a lot of black and chrome and stuff like that, I didn't want everything to, especially with the chrome, I didn't want it to overpower. So it just gave me a beautiful light that came and lit the drums beautifully. So I was able to get him to move, because the light was, that's it, it's not moving. So I was getting him to move because I did some Rembrandt lighting, which just kind of lights part of the eye on one side, which I think is absolutely beautiful, it's kind of dramatic. Then I had Jeff Chase, help me with a reflector. So then half of the shoot, the light was coming in, hitting the reflector on the other side to clean up the shadow on the other. And then I just had him move according to, as he moved more towards the light, suddenly he would be more lit evenly versus at an angle where one side is all shadow. So by basically setting the light properly, setting him and getting him to move a little bit, and myself, different angles, we were able to create different looks without having to change the light every 5 seconds or moving the lights. So that's the beauty of you working with minimal equipment. And in this case, one light just works beautifully. Whether you're a business person, whether you're an artist, whether you're whatever you're photographing, people are passionate about what they're doing. So when you're photographing somebody that's really passionate about what they're doing, it transmits to me. So I feed off of that, and hopefully they feed off of that also. And a lot of people I've photographed through the years, for an example, a lot of people are shy in front of the camera. But when you get them talking about what they are passionate about or what they love, they know what they're talking about and they become very comfortable. So that to me is the key. Get people, it's not about me. It's about the photographer. It's about the person in front of the camera. So once that person talks or is comfortable with either his or her surroundings or talking about what they love, they immediately get comfortable. So that's a key as a portrait photographer or commercial photographer, especially working with people, is to get the people in front of the camera to relax, because that's when you get all the expressions and you get all and you can get them to do a lot of stuff that will enhance what your vision is.